But I also must admit that I'm also humble by this occasion, almost speechless in the moment of thinking what a speech could be here in this moment. Ada Louise Huxtable, she was such an extraordinary force in architecture that I feel almost as an impostor, exactly like Jasmine felt before, by having my name even associated with hers. What can I possibly have done to merit this recognition? Self-doubt, of course, in the face of such awards is a well-known topos, so I won't dwell further on it other than to acknowledge, even if it is just to myself, that it is here with me, acknowledging one's ghost, that is. A lifetime award, someone said to me, oh, that's really frightening, I thought. Because, of course, I think of myself still in many ways like a kid, and perhaps this is what brings me closer to Ada Louise, in the sense of speaking against the grain in every occasion, no matter how inconvenient, a certain kind of fearlessness which has sustained me, I realize, since I was a child, in the face of any kind of adversity, opposition, doubt, or outright rejection. On the contrary, I can see how much I got gained from each one of those situations, and retroactively, I'm immensely grateful for every setback I have had in my life. So, my dear friends, let's not so much lament our plight as women in architecture, in academia, or in the street, and let's get on with the program, because an immense amount of energy and force can also be gained from not having your authority taken for granted. Ada Louise is actually not particularly known for her commitment to the W question, as you have decided, to my delight, I must say, to rename these awards. But it is there if you pay attention. Take her 1970 review of an exhibition of Bruce Goff in the Architectural League in New York, Peacock Feathers and Pink Plastic. The title is already a slap in the face of a stiff architecture discourse. But listen to this. Go to the league, gentlemen and ladies. Architects are still in that order professionally. So she's paying attention to, you know, they are still in that order, right? Even if those gold and silver presentation boards and houses like starfish, Viking ships and TPs give you fits, if you can set that eugenically frightening New England Calvinist Harvard Bauhaus intellectual frigidity, if you can suppress a reaction to some obviously homegrown corn, there is an artist here. Where did we stop writing this way? I mean, I really want to be, I always like to twist things a little bit, so I'm sorry, I'm going to do this so I can also see the images. But, I mean, I want to be more like her, if anything, and this award, of course, has helped me to look back at what she wrote, and I'm totally fascinated. Of course, Goff was a gay architect. You didn't read the quote from the title of Ada Louise's article, whose career I discovered recently when I went to Oklahoma. There was a big exhibition of Goff as a teacher and the Oklahoma School of Architecture, which was really amazing. But it was cut short. You know why? It ended abruptly in 1955 because he was framed by the police and accused of homosexuality, which was still a crime. So this is in this context that I discovered Ada Louise writing about Bruce Goff in the 70s. A very dear friend of mine, Paul Preciado, a former student of mine, transitioned a few years ago. You may know his work from her earlier, or his earlier name, Beatriz Preciado. I saw him recently in a conference in Porto, and I had a question, an urgent question. How is it? How is it? He repeated to me, yes, how is it to be a man after all these years as a woman? And the answer, oh, incredible. People treat you so much better. I go to the market in Barcelona, and the fishmonger, a woman, wants to attend me first, despite the fact that there is a whole group of women ahead of me. Let's see what the young man once and gives me the best fish in her stand and prepares it carefully, packaging tenderly and saying goodbye and I hope you enjoy it and to see you back soon. So there, right? Even getting fish in the market, you are better off as a man. My father wanted very much that I would have been a boy, particularly after my older sister was born. And by the time the third sister arrived, my mother says that his face turned white. I didn't ask him what color, I didn't dare to ask, what color he turned when the fourth girl was born, who was really the fifth sibling, because by then the fourth had finally been arrived and had finally been a boy. Okay, so there are even, or some of us, are really a disappointment at birth already, before we even have done anything or say anything. Nevertheless, I must say, if he was disappointed, he hid it very well. I only know that because who knows why my mother one day just said to me like that, and I thought, oh, he wanted you to be a boy, you know, and I don't know why he said this thing that he turned white, not at my birth, but at the birth of the third one. Anyway, the story is that I'm incredibly grateful to my father, who always say to us, to all of us when we were little, that a woman could do anything a man does, and perhaps even better, and that in particular, architecture was a perfect profession for a woman. Imagine that. Where did he get this idea from? The idea that a woman could do anything in their life. Everything else in my life contradicted it. The school that I was attending, my extended family of aunts and uncles and cousins and grandparents. I remember very well Christmas days and other such celebrations. My aunts telling us how beautiful we look and how well dressed we were and how my mother had such great taste for clothes and which she did. She has a great sense of fashion. And my father immediately objecting that the important thing was how we were doing in school and not how we look. And this, of course, sounds right now, but at the time, in that context, I must tell you, it sounded really awkward that your father is saying awkward things, and even eccentric, and he was really an eccentric. And my aunts immediately protesting and joking and saying that your father says such weird things, and immediately telling us, don't pay any attention, or you will never get married. Okay, but I did pay attention, of course, and I think I always had my eyes on the horizon. I even went on to go to architecture school, first in Valencia, where I was the only woman, the only woman in the school. I mean, it's true that it was a whole new program. It was a polytechnic, and all of a sudden we were studying together with the engineers. It's not that there were not women in Madrid, for example, but this was a new program, 2,000 students in the first semester, 200 in the second semester. There were no women anymore. 20 in the third semester, I said to myself, I've got to get out of here. And then, of course, I went to Barcelona. I transferred to Barcelona, where there were some women, maybe 10% in the upper classes, but it really felt like a crowd and very liberating. In any case, I never felt that any of this in any way was an obstacle. I didn't even think about it. I had no feminist consciousness whatsoever. Even if I had a very quite developed political consciousness by then, particularly after I arrived in Barcelona, these are the last years of the Franco dictatorship. We seem to be spending more time in the streets and making little magazines such as this one, of which I was the editor, than in the classroom. It was only in New York and in the early 80s, and in the context of a very active an activist group of women artists, filmmakers, art critics, writers, that I woke up. It was also then, and ironically, that I first encountered sexism in the academia, and if not open, racism. One thinks of the USA, of course, as more progressive than macho Spain, but no, I was shocked. I had only experienced respect and support in Barcelona, but once again, despite all of this, I benefited enormously from this kind of suspicion. Oh, her accent is weird. Is she from Latin America? Is, you know, these kinds of things. I benefited enormously from this kind of things happening. In many ways, my work and my thinking particularly the interdisciplinary nature of feminist work in these years that has stayed with me since then. So now I will show you 10 projects, which I have to go back to think about it, right? From that moment on, that moment in New York, a kind of cross section of my work, the kind of things I never do, maybe because I don't want to know what I do, as if thinking about what I'm doing perhaps will have the effect that I won't do it anymore, as if when you think about how you are riding a bicycle, you may actually fall. This is, of course, going to be it's better not to think about it. This is, of course, going to be very fast, a kind of blur of images, almost like as a movie, as if I was just one project that keeps flickering like a fast-track portfolio, treating myself as an architect, which in fact, as I said before, what I was trained first to be before sliding into history and pedagogy, just as Ada Louise slid from art history into architectural criticism. So here is the first project, or here is me in that period in the 80s in New York, Sexuality and space, of course, it started as an interdisciplinary conference that I organized at Princeton University in 1990 to address the question of gender, sexual orientation, and sexuality in architecture. Of course, the questions had been explored in transformative ways in literature, in film studies, in psychoanalysis, in sociology, but architecture scholarship had seemingly immunized itself against this discourse. As a result, architectural education and practice operated in a kind of, as is the form of buildings, was somehow innocent of these more complex, subtle, and even controversial dimensions. Of course, important work on gender had been done, and this is from that conference. Important work on gender had been done in the 70s by such figures as Denise Scott Brown and Cilla de Bretteville, for example. But this innovative work and urgent work have gave way in the 80s to a kind of essentialist discourse on women and design. My idea was to complicate the whole thing in a non-binary way precisely and to diversify the expertise to include film theories, television, art, popular culture, philosophers, etc. The goal of the project was modest, even local in the sense that I was trying to address the gender imbalance in faculty and students in the School of Architecture. Imagine, I arrived at Princeton and I was like a flashback to Valencia. I was the only woman teaching there, right? I came from Columbia University to teach there in 1980. I look around the table in the first faculty meeting, there is no women there, no one. I thought to myself, this is bizarre, where I am? What is this? I should go back to New York. Then I start looking at the student body, and this is also very strange. There are only like 20 or 30 perhaps percent of women. So in one of the faculty meetings, I raised the issue. And they say, oh no, it's the same everywhere. I say, excuse me, but I just came from Columbia University. There are 50% students at Columbia. So. To the credit of Bob Maxwell, who was then the dean, he let me organize this conference, which has, of course, an incredible effect because somehow the conference and the book went all over the place, and it gave people the sense that Princeton have changed. It had not changed. It will only start to change the next year when I was able to convince the dean to hire Liz Diller, who was a very close friend of mine, so that there will be one woman in design. And so, little by little, Princeton started to change. Meanwhile, of course, these questions have been present in all of my projects, most obviously in my studies of Eileen Gray, of Lina Bobardi, Rachel Wiley, Louise Bourgeois, Denise Scott Brown, etc., but also very much in my current work on collaborations, exploring the secret life of modern architecture with so many hidden women, but also queer designers excluded from the credit. So privacy and publicity. 1994 was my first book, which was based on my recently finished dissertation. It was a close reading of Adolf Loos and Le Corbusier. And the book challenged the traditional narrative by arguing that modern architecture is inseparable from the emerging media of its time, photography, illustrated journals, advertising, film, radio. The book sees the mass media as the true side between which modern architecture was produced. Of course, this did not mean at all abandoning the design of objects, the building, but rather looking at them in a different way. Of course, the book, again, was translated into many languages, and it's in its 7 editions, so it went also beyond what I had in many ways anticipating. Media and Modernity is an interdisciplinary program that I started at Princeton. I founded this program in the year 2000 as a new interdisciplinary program to study the cultural formations that came into prominence in the last century, with a special attention to the interplay between culture and technology. The spirit of the program, to make it short, is collaborative between disciplines and between generations, with the students, for example, themselves designing the posters, so that's why they are so different depending on the year, right? In recent years, in fact, a crucial focus of this program has been contemporary scholarship and activism that deals with the current events and tackles the underlying fault lines of racism, global migration, climate change, and politics. But for me, what is important is that these interdisciplinary conversations on such issues that are happening everywhere in the university are hosted precisely in a school of architecture, allowing design to rethink itself, but also allowing design to contribute to the most urgent of debates. Domesticity at War. This book was about post-war American design and revealing its kind of intimate relationship with war, just as manufacturers were turning wartime industry to peacetime, missiles to washing machines. Designers and cultural institutions were recycling the techniques, the materials, and ways of doing that were developed by the military weaponry into livingry, as back Mr. Fuller put it. The design of the book devised the text and images offering a kind of interactive flip book evoking the deluge images of the period. During this time, designers crafted seductive images of idealized domesticity for a global audience. Even the image of the architect changed from the heroic figure of the modern movement, serious, masculine, austere, formally dressed, earnest, in public, to the domesticated agents of the post-war, like happy couples, like the Eames there, adoringly looking at the model of their first version of their Eames house, as if it was a newborn baby, pleasure-seeking figures, sexual, sensual, casually dressed, relaxed, and at home. Cold War anxieties about nuclear devastation were masked by endlessly multiplied images of a perfected domestic environment and permanent smiles. The context of writing this book is very important to me because the book was started basically between the first Gulf War and 9/11. In fact, we were living 200 meters away from the towers, so we leave it really in the front line. And it was actually during this period when Cold War anxieties were giving way to hot wars, raising again the question of the relationship between design and war. So for example, what you see there, the gas masks, those are not from the 50s, but were the kind of advertisements that you find in the New York Times during the 90s. And of course, this raincoat, which is like a safe home where you can fill it with newspapers for warmth. And the Museum of Modern Art was selling such as tools for survival. Clip Stand Fall, the radical architecture of little magazines, was an exhibition that went from 2006 to like 2012 or so, a series of exhibitions and resulting book that started from my initiative over the last 20 years to transform architectural doctoral education by bringing design and research together, working collaboratively with PhD students to make exhibitions, publications, and public debate. Krippenstein Fall documents over 5 years of research into these little magazines that transform architecture and design discourse in the 60s and 70s. Countercultural design magazines of this period, by the way, in the 70s, were filled with images of people living with the AIDS, for example, of respiratory devices, unless something was to be radically changed in the management of global resources. Little magazines also were repeatedly addressing ecology and planetary survival. This call for sustainable strategies and experiments with organic farming, recycling, and sharing economy mark, of course, the rise of the environmental movement between the realm of the design imagination. Of course, until recently, designers and architects dropped the ball, except with very fantastic exceptions, on this very urgent issue. And it's important, I think, for us as historians also to recover this historical legacy of environmental activism in design thinking and experimentation. The book was designed also to be a resource with facsimiles of the magazines, interviews, oral histories, conversations, and it also documents the first 6 exhibitions that took place from Storefront in New York to the AA in London to Documenta in Kassel to Oslo to Latin America to Chile, Bogota, etc. You can see here multiple shots of the exhibition. Okay, radical pedagogies, another such pedagogical experiment. It's a major collaborative research project over the last 8 years. That has culminated again in a series of events, international exhibitions, etc., and also a living archive and a forthcoming book. The innovation of this project is that instead of just working with the PhD students at Princeton, we have assembled a global network of over 80 prominent and also very young design theorists and historians from more than 24 countries to explore more than 100 pedagogical experiments in the second half of the 20th century that challenged normative thinking about design. These experiments were directly linked to activist protests against the status quo. So you have idealized images of communitarian ecological futures juxtaposed with images of urban inequalities and activism in the street, whether the street is Yale, Free the Panthers, this is the moment in which the School of Architecture is occupied, the building was burned, and the students are in the street protesting the Panthers, the arrest, and in, for example, in Mexico. Right? These experiments were often small and on the fringes of institutions and short-lived, but they have a very long-lasting effect on design education. Furthermore, what is important to me today is to address issues, again, such as inequality, sustainability, computation, user participation, race, gender, new materials, informal settlements, and disabilities, which are all, again, becoming very urgent issues today. So where did we forget? Since we were doing this fantastic work in the 70s, what happened in the meantime, right? So you have all these different cases, the question of disabilities, for example, with the students of Berkeley very much actively collaborating with a group of disabled veterans from the Vietnam War to make the campus accessible. And of course, this is the exhibition that was in the Venice Biennale, even won a prize in the Venice Biennale, and then went from there to Warsaw and to many other places. It was also in Lisbon, etc. Playboy architecture may be a little bit surprising, but I think it's an example of finding design and architecture where you least expected. Because in fact, sex, architecture, and design were inextricably linked in the pages of Playboy magazine, believe it or not, from the very beginning. Architecture was not simply a feature in the magazine, but it was its very mechanism. The sexual fantasies and the architecture of fantasies were inseparable. The sign actually turned out to be more seductive than the playmate. It became the ultimate playmate. With its global circulation of more than 7 million copies at its peak and the sexualization of the sign, I think you can argue that Playboy had more influence in the dissemination of modern architecture and design than professional magazines, interior magazines, and even institutions like the Museum of Modern Art. From the very first issue, most of the leading contemporary designs, you can see Fran Jorroyd, Mies van der Rohe, etc., the whole 50s generation of Saarinen in the IMS, Noise, etc., were always featured and interviewed in the magazine, with their design playing a prominent role in shaping an idealized interior. In fact, Playboy architecture is all about the interior. The Playboy is an indoors man. The magazine was relentlessly obsessed with this interior, and this interior turns out to be infinite, which is kind of a premonition also of our times. You are invited to dive into a world without gaps, without cracks, without decay, an infinite perfected interior, a total work of art liberated by modern design. Here again is the exhibition that was in multiple places, in the NIE in Maastricht, and then in Rotterdam, in the Museum of the Dam, the Museum of Architecture of Frankfurt, in the Elmors Museum in Chicago, and in Barcelona. Here are some images of the exhibition in the NIE in Maastricht. The century of the bed, this project began in 2014 when I was invited to be chief curator of something called Curated by Vienna, which is a citywide set of exhibitions that involves 22 art galleries with their own curators and their own exhibition designers, and you are supposed to give them a theme and work with them in the development of that theme. And I came up with the idea of the Century of the Bed, which was also the title of the resulting book. The point here is that the city is not what it used to be. What is private and what is public has become completely blurred. We can no longer think of distinctive spaces or distinct spaces for work, play, domesticity, and rest. We are living in a 24/7 culture. Post-industrialization collapses work back into the home and further into the bedroom and into the bed itself. I mean, in that sense, maybe Hefner was ahead of his time, but look at these advertisements, collaborate in bed, for example. Since then, I have staged numerous bed-ins around the world, inviting by now more than 100 diverse protagonists from design, but also from medicine, from philosophy, from architecture, from art, sociology, activism, etc., to discuss this shifting role of the bed in a time when smartphones are the first thing and the last things that we touch every day. So how does this convergence of smart technology, flexible working conditions, the rise of the gig economy, and young professionals' nomadic styles impact the significance of the bed as a site of labor, of leisure, and of surveillance? What does this mean for design? These performances, of course, reproduce the iconic bed of the Amsterdam Hilton Hotel when John Lennon and Yoko Ono held their peace bedding for peace in 1969. These performances were staged in the Design Biennale. Here I am, for example, with Leslie Loco, with Hans-Ulrich Olbricht, with Madeleine Olbricht, with James Taylor, but also here in the Serpentine in London, here with Mark Kassen, with Farshid Mousavi, and in Berlin and in other places around the world. Each of the guests is invited to sleep into their pajamas and join me in bed to rethink the significance of the bed in the age of social media and the sharing economy. And what I discovered is something incredible. When you people put on their pajamas and they get in bed, the conversation completely changes and they start saying things they have never said before. So, so we start recording all of this and probably we should do a book or a film or something because it's amazing what people say when they are relaxed finally. Right? And particularly in the Biennale, when everybody is so exhausted, they were so happy to get in bed, even if it was for 10 minutes, and talk. Right. Next project is Are We Human? This is a project that I did in collaboration with my partner, Mark Wigley, who is here and came with me. Thank you, Mark, for supporting me for 32 years or so, and for coming with me for this occasion. When curating the Istanbul Design Biennale in 2016, the first question we asked ourselves is what is design in a time in which absolutely everything is design, from objects to online identities, interfaces, networks, data, chemicals, organisms, political strategies, genetic codes, and even the weather. We literally live inside the sign, like the spider lives inside the web, constructed from inside the inside of its own body. The Biennale tried to show that the sign is what makes us human from the very first stone and hand axes, and painted cell necklaces to the hole in the ocean layer. That's also our work. To talk about design in that sense is to talk about the state of our species. And of course, this is an urgent question when we seem to have designed even our own extinction, along with that of countless other species, or as this poor bird filled with plastic. In addition to the exhibition, and these are some shots of the exhibition, of course, Ebola deemed very important during that moment. In addition to the catalog on the right, we also developed this little book entitled Are We Human? Notes on an Archaeology of Design. And we also collaborated with our partners and colleagues in IFLAX to curate an online archive of another 100 or so interdisciplinary voices addressing the question of the human. Under the title Superhumanity, we published a couple of other books. And here again, some shots of the exhibition. And let me just move to my last project, which is X-ray architecture. My last project is also my earliest project because this bond between architecture and illness is probably my longest preoccupation. It goes back to the year I moved to New York at the end of 1980. Where I landed as visiting a scholar completely by chance and by incredible luck in the New York Institute for the Humanities, where there were extraordinary figures such as Susan Sontag, whose book Illness as Metaphor had recently been published, and all of a sudden I started seeing modern architecture in terms of all the pathologies related to it, real or imagined. So agoraphobia, claustrophobia, nervous disorders, and above all, of course, tuberculosis, and our obsession, and the obsession of that generation, with hygiene, with germs, with fresh air. Now, of course, it sounds very familiar right now. This is the subject of this book, believe it or not. These images that you see there, for example, is the Tugendhat house that was when was abandoned during the occupation of the house, the occupation of Czechoslovakia. And finally, in the hands of communists, they didn't know what to do with it, and they turned it into a gym for disabled kids. So this association between architecture and health is very, very important. My current project in many ways is on health and architecture in the 21st century, which is the age, of course, of neurological disorders, environmental allergies of every kind, the microbiome, and the crisis of diversity and climate change. If the X-ray project is about the intimate relationship between architecture and the health of the human, the focus has now shifted to the health of the planet. Not just in my work, but in general. We have been totally focused in the 20th century with the health of our bodies, and now what we see sick is our own planet. Once again, historical design research meets contemporary urgency. In an uncanny echo of the 19th century epidemic, think about that, cholera in Palermo, in 1835, and all these images that we have seen recently in the press. So once again, historical design research meets contemporary urgency. In an uncanny echo of the 19th century epidemics that revolutionized the design of interiors, furnishings, buildings, and cities, design will be called into action, grasping the entangled interrelationship between microorganisms and the planet. So here you have it in a kind of self-portrait that I have never shown, not even to myself, but it's at least, or the least, that I could offer you to indicate the seriousness with which I accept this award and with the deep gratitude for your support for this obviously crazy enterprise. Thank you very much.